Those sweet sounds of T.I.'s Doing My Job means it's time for the Hakamon Hookup, where we hook your ass up with a job lead, come and get it, you mangy cat.
I put people on, understand? Streets was happy. Everybody could eat.
Now, these jobs aren't just for people who that we thought were dead and come back to life. Who are these jobs for?
Everyone!
No, no, these jobs aren't just for people who get elected and are dead. Who are these jobs for?
Everyone!
No, no, these jobs aren't just for people with a lack of activity, so they decide to kill.
Everyone!
Word to Gary Oldman. But we're not doing that today. Ladies and gentlemen, we have Vagabond Maurice in the building, and we're gonna talk to Vagabond about his new album, which is called Garden at the End of the World.
Yep.
Yes.
Such a good title.
It's a great title, right? Garden at the End of the World. I love this title. So I usually like to ask people how did they get started or how they get into it, but I think I've asked you that already.
Yeah.
So what I want to do is kind of focus on this project.
Okay.
How did you get the title of that project, and what does that title even mean?
Well, you know, that title is inspired by many things. One, I think I was reading this book called A Restaurant at the End of the Universe, and that led me into this documentary called A Garden at the End of the World, which then led me into this like kid's book named A Garden at the End of the World, right? Mm-hmm. And I was just like, I just love that title, you know, because, you know, it was talking about the diaspora of Muslim women in this a certain section, and also like the book, which is completely different synopsis about just like, you know, a gardener who grows his garden while the world is ending or something, right? And I was just like, I just like that concept. So in my last album, the second track of the project, of that album is called A Garden at the End of the World. Uh-huh. And I was just like, what I like to do in each project is like drop a nugget of, you know, reference to what the next thing might be called.
Yeah.
So I was just like, okay, well, I already made a song called this, and like I like the sound direction of that certain song, so I was just like, now I'm gonna lift this and make it into this whole album, you know.
So, oh, nice. So yeah, this expanded from that one song.
Yeah.
You took us on a journey with just expanding that one song.
Yeah, exactly.
Which is a great idea.
Yeah.
It's almost like, you know your brand.
Yeah, no, definitely.
You know what I'm saying?
Without a doubt. And it came together like so easily and quickly, man.
And now that's another question. Mm. We say it came together easily and quickly.
Mm.
Can you tell me how the process happened of you hooking up with Brad Kemp? Shout out to Brad.
Yeah,
Kemp.
Shout out to Brad. I hope he's listening.
He's
probably at the studio like, oh, man, I wish I was there. Man, I hooked up with Brad through chores, actually. Mm-hmm. You know, I was looking for another studio space to go to. And then chores was just like, he was like, yo, Maurice, you know, come through the studio, record with me. And then, like, me and Brad just clicked. And then I would go to him for, you know, a couple of my singles that I dropped earlier this year. And then one of the singles, which is actually the fourth song on my album, when we recorded that, I was just like, you know, I was just putting out a single a month. And I was just like, you know what? Wait a minute. This song right here, it's kind of too fly. Mm-hmm. I think I want to build something more from this, like, this one song, you know? Because, like, singles are cool for me. Like, singles are cool with any artist. But me, I'm more so a project artist, you know? I like to build the concept and like expand that. Mm-hmm. So me and Brad connected through chores, and then we just started working, you know. The first song that me and Brad did, where he produced, was a song called String from the Sky, which was featured on this online like big beat tape by Inner Ocean Records. Okay. And mind you, so this long beat tape was like 2 hours long of just like a lot of instrumentalists and stuff like that,
dope.
Right?
Yeah.
And I was one of two vocalists on that, right?
Oh, wow.
So like it was such an honor because, you know, instrumentals are cool. Like I love instrumentation, but then it's just like to have a vocalist on the track brings it to a whole different level. And like, you know, I saw the reception from that and people were just like, oh man, you're from the Inner Oceans thing. Oh man, that's so dope, blah, blah, blah. And I was just like, oh yeah, listen to the rest of the music, you know?
Right, right.
So like that was the first thing me and Brad came up with. And then from there, everything was like butter, you know? Like I think I started working on this project in May. Yeah, that's when the single was finished, in May. And then we just took the summer, was working on stuff, and then we hit it hard August and September and got it out.
Oh, now see, something that you said was interesting was like you like projects.
Yeah.
So if you could surmise what the story we're hearing on mm-hmm. this project is, could you break it down within a paragraph or maybe even two?
Yeah. Honestly, essentially it's a journey to all my tapes are a journey to find enlightenment or whatever, right? But this one specifically is about finding happiness, nurturing happiness, right? Because each song is, you know, capped off with passages from this book called No Mud, No Lotus by a Zen Buddhist monk, Thich Nhat Hanh. And, like, so he describes the five steps of nurturing happiness, and that's what each song has, like, the first step, the second step, the third step, fourth step, okay. right? So, like, it's me following this journey of reaching happiness and, like, attaining that happiness and, like, nurturing that happiness, you know? Because, like, the world is a hard place, you know?
Yeah.
You need you need to figure out some ways, you know, to, like, a lot of self-care, you know? Mm-hmm. So that's essentially what the project is. Happiness and me just spitting and spitting
and spitting. And spitting. Now, it's interesting. Your writing, I really can hear that, you know, there's messaging in it.
Mm-hmm.
But something else that I really can appreciate is how you rhyme.
Mm.
Because sometimes you have the multisyllabic thing going, yeah. which is great. But, like, how important is it to you? And I know the answer, and if you can elaborate on it, how important is it for you to have good writing in these songs?
Man, it's really important. Because, like, my background is fiction writing. I went to college for fiction writing, right?
Oh, I didn't know that.
And then I was also a slam poet for a long time. So I went from, like, big short stories to condensing into, like, 3-minute poems to condensing it into, like, 16 bars, right? So it was, like, hyperliteracy. That's all I've been doing, condensing the form of it, you know. And it's really important to me because, you know, all the people that inspired me from, like, you know, Black Thought, you know, Tribe Called Quest, Native Tongue Posse, you know, Soulquarians, uh-huh. Mos Def, Common, like, all these people are, like, the conscious rappers, right?
Yeah, quote,
the conscious rappers, right?
Yeah, but I would like the terminology, the actual rappers.
Yeah, I feel you. That's how I feel, you know. You know, and so it's like I was inspired by all these people, you know. So it was just like, you know, I, you know, in high school and like elementary when I was listening to them, like I learned a lot from just like deciphering their lyrics and stuff like that. And like my mom, it's real old school. My mom would take me to the library because I'd be like, oh, who's this poet? And then my mom was just like, oh, let's go figure it out. Took me to the library. I just go pick out the books and like read poets or literature that they would mention in their rhymes. And then I just expanded it from there.
Oh, wow. So you did the homework.
Yeah. I did the knowledge, man. Yeah.
I mean, I didn't necessarily go that hard. But, you know, I was a big fan of the RZA.
Yeah.
And so you gotta have a dictionary to listen to the RZA. But I did like learn he helped me with a math problem, like being perpendicular to the square.
Nah.
I was like, you know what? What was my geometry teacher talking about? It actually made me care for about real. School.
Yeah.
That's not what they do anymore. But not what rappers do. Yeah. But like it's great to see somebody. And how old are you?
Just turned 30 this year.
Well, somebody as young as you, and I'm not that much older, but like somebody as young as you to actually take your lyrics as seriously as you do your messaging. And so when you were talking about these particular rappers that you listen to, a lot of those guys were 5%ers.
Yeah, definitely.
Now, do you delve into that religion? Like, do you consider yourself a part of that religion, or are you like somebody like myself who are like, oh, I'm gonna take what I can get from that and then go on about my business?
Yeah. That's how I am. I'll take what I can get from that and then, like, you know, apply it to, you know, myself, you know, because even now I would say I've been researching Buddhism for a long time, so I'm just like, I'm pretty much a Buddha, you know, pretty much Buddhist. Because like I remember I was talking to somebody at a gig like a couple weeks ago, and I was explaining something. I was like, yeah, this, that, and this, you know, all about anger. I was just like, yo, in Buddhism they call it, you know, watering seeds. And I was just like, oh, okay, I guess I'm in this. You know, but yeah, definitely when I was growing up, my older brother actually got into that heavily, right? Mm-hmm. And then he would come to me with the knowledge, you know, so like the supreme mathematics, you know, the alphabets, like I have that. I'm off cuff with that. You know?
That's awesome, because that was like a big thing in like during that time. So you know, there is a scene, and you're from here, right?
No, I'm from Minnesota.
Oh, well, never mind.
But no, Minneapolis. Hey.
In the scene here, that was a big part of hip hop too.
Mm-hmm.
So like you would go out and hang out with the graffiti writers and you know, go to the parties or whatever, but then certain subjects would come up and it's like, oh, I don't know about this. I gotta figure this out.
Yeah.
And then certain individuals would school you real quick.
Right.
So now you don't look like Boo Boo the Fool.
Right, exactly.
Because that was like the thing, to be intelligent.
Mm-hmm.
You know, to actually articulate. You know what I mean?
Yeah, exactly.
You know, but now you watch the culture just gets buried into idiocy.
Mm.
Dude Migos. What?
I would say that's corporations pulling up the idiocy, right?
Yeah.
You know, not necessarily...
Yeah. It's top down, not bottom up.
Yeah.
And everything.
Probably.
That sounds like some freaky stuff.
Yeah.
It is.
Made it weird.
It is.
But like all that stuff, like all of the new rap isn't, you know, I'm not going to sit up here and just crap on everyone.
Right. Because the scene is out there still. You know, people making music.
And like I'll sit here and go on record. I'm a huge French Montana fan.
Yeah.
You know, but French Montana's got a bunch of like poppy and commercial stuff.
Right.
But then he's got all this other like gritty stuff that he used to do.
Mm-hmm.
And he still is like a Muslim and he still lives by that code and creed. People don't really honor a code and creed that much anymore. Mm-hmm. So like what you do not on the mic, it also means a lot.
Yeah, definitely.
You know, and I really appreciate that you do delve into not only the culture of music, but just the culture of being a human being.
Yeah, definitely.
And it resonates through your sound. So I want to say that. Does anybody else have any more questions?
We right here. We about to go in. I feel you guys.
I was about to tell you another.
Let's delve into it.
All right.
As-salamu alaykum.
Right, as-salamu alaykum, absolutely. Man. Yeah, absolutely. We used to go watch Farrakhan speak when I was a little boy, man.
Oh, man. I mean, different aspects of the music as well. It's just like anime and jazz music, you know. I'm a big 90s kid as well, so that's always what people like gravitate towards as well. They're like, oh, man, I love anime too. And I'm just like, but, you know, this is all like one thing for me, you know.
Do you know martial arts? Because you do reference martial arts.
Yeah. I've done martial arts for a long time. On and off, like, just this year, I went back and started taking Aikido classes. I got to get back into it. But, that's one of the things that definitely helped me in the process of writing this project. Because, you know, I was just like, I need to align my mind, body, and spirit, you know. So I was just like,
I need to work out.
Yeah, I started doing, like, bodyweight workouts and stuff like that, doing like pull-ups and stuff. And then also I was just like, all right, now I need to do something that actually works out different muscle groups. So I started doing Aikido. You know, I'm not a stranger to martial arts. I used to do Muay Thai for the longest time, and then I also did Wing Chun for a long time as well, and then I stopped and I was just like, all right, cool. And now I'm just like, but getting back into martial arts, I wanted to do Aikido because it's more so about defense than it is about offense.
Yeah,
you know, so I'm just like, I'm tired of striking. Let me just chill out. And I just love the philosophy of like the circular steps, the motions and everything. It just flows, you know.
Yeah.
And then like the founder of Aikido, Sensei Morihei, he actually wrote this book called The Art of Peace, which is kind of like an antithesis to The Art of War by Sun Tzu. Okay. And it's all about like just being peaceful, defending yourself, and all of this. So I was just like, give me all this energy, please.
Yeah, it's The Art of Peace.
Yeah, man.
So you are a busy person with entertainment. And so sometimes it is hard to date.
Yeah.
Yeah. And this is almost a little low-key segue into the next segment.
Anyway. Okay.
But you do want to date somebody.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, not to put your business out in the street, but, if I'm correct in my remembering your personal life, you were dating or are dating or have had an interaction with someone who entertains.
Mm-hmm.
How much easier is that to date that type of person than it is to date a normal person?
Hey, can I just say I appreciate you not putting my business out like that? You're slick. Oh, you slick. Hey, shout out to my girl. Oh, I love her.
Respect.
I do this for real.
It's really dope. It's really easy. It's funny because like even before me and her got together, I was just like, I'm tired of dating these poets and blah blah blah. Uh-huh. But like, you know, it's easy because like I guess it's like the same avenue of like hip hop, but then also her background is different from you know the culture. So it's just like seeing the way that those two things intertwine is dope. So me and her, we balance each other out like indefinitely, you know. And it makes things a lot easier because, like, she gives me feedback on things. She sends me some of the things that she's working on and stuff like that. And we just, like, it's dope. It just grows, you know. It just it makes me happy, you know, just to
on be multiple on
the,
levels.
Yeah, too. Just to be on the same wavelength and stuff, you know, because, like, you know, when you start out dating someone, it's just like, how much can we say, blah, blah, blah. But now it's just like, yo, boom, I just wrote this. I'm just like, woo. You going in, you know.
I'm so juvenile. I was thinking when you said how much can you say, you're like, hey babe, I'm on the toilet right now taking a dump. So after I wipe my butt crack, I'm gonna come through and see you. But that broccoli I had last night was crazy. I love you, all right? You know? All right. Do you guys have any other questions?
Aikido, Steven Seagal, pro or con?
You know what? Out of all the action martial artists that came out, I was just like, I hated Steven Seagal with passion. I was just like, this just looks fake, man. I was like, yo, I don't like it. But like Michael Jai White, yeah, he's dope.
He's super cool.
Solid.
And really funny at Black Dynamite.
Yeah.
And no, Seagal, I mean, it seemed like, especially at a certain point, he wouldn't even run up to the guy.
All right.
He would just do like one move, like, and then his fall. It's like, come on, guys.
Also, pound for pound, the most destructive defender of peace and other people. Like, you know, he is defending some guy's hot dog stand.
We've talked about this.
This has come up many times.
Or it's like, who's paying for that?
Scratches the place.
Yeah.
In the name of defending
the right. guy. Right. Yeah.
Makes total sense that he's a Trump and Putin friend when you think about it, which I probably not very Aikido if you.
Right.
I don't even really know. But
dang. I didn't even know that about Steven.
He's a gross individual.
That's why I don't like him.
Yeah,
I felt that energy.
He's a piece of garbage.
Also had that reality television show, Lawman, which I don't know if
anyone
remembers.
I remember that crap.
Pretty good. It's crap. It's fascinating garbage.
I like that terminology. Garbage. Fascinating garbage.
Yeah. Like most reality shows.
Right.
Amy, anything?
Ooh, so you said you started in poetry. Have you done a lot with Heartland Cafe?
No, I haven't actually. Jesus. No.
Oh man. They've booked me for like comedy. They've been pretty open to things.
Oh, sick.
Yeah.
Oh, well, now I'll hit them up. Shout out to them.
Can you plug
you can find everything online, vagabondmaurice.com. That's my official website that I build. Shout out to Squarespace. They hooked me up. And also everything is on Spotify, SoundCloud, Bandcamp, you know, anywhere you can stream music. And then, like, yeah, follow me, say what up. You know, I'm a nice individual.
Yes, you are. Yeah, you know? Well, that'll do it for the Hakamon hookup, where we hook your ass up with a job lead coming to get at you, mangy cats.
I put people on, understand? Streets was happy. Everybody could eat.
But we didn't do that. We spoke about everything from culture and hip hop. And this interview was not just for people who understand culture and hip hop. Who is this interview for?
Everyone!
No, these are not. This interview wasn't just for people who love the Wu-Tang and got their life changed by hip hop in a positive way. Hey. Who are these? Who is this interview for?
Everyone!
No, it just wasn't for people that realized that Steven Seagal's a piece of garbage.
Yep.
Who is this interview for? Word to Gary Oldman. Ladies and gentlemen, we come back. We're going to go into the ins and outs relationship advice, where we crack open the novel of my love life and realize this isn't a poetry book, but something that somebody...